trying to bring a perspective, a new aspect of history, of mythology, of mythological character, and somewhere you are kind of establishing the relevance of it in the present time. This is so fascinating. I just wanted to put it on the table.
That's wonderful. Thank you so much. Yes, I try hard.
So this time when you are writing the book, what were the thought behind it?
Well, Draupadi Kuru is very much about the women, you know, and there's obviously a lot of issues dealing with the women, you know, and there was a lot of loose ends, and there was a lot of women's rights issues and all of that. So that was a natural space to go into for the women. Part two is supposed to be about the men, you know. So when you think about the Mahabharata and stuff, you know, the men as well didn't exactly have a perfect life, you know. I mean, yes, they were kings, yes, true. They won battles and all of that stuff. But at the end of the day, given a choice, would they have chosen to do exactly what they did? I don't think so, you know. So I think this was also a kind of second coming of age for the men. So we had a second coming of age for the women, and now it's the men's turn. So basically the five Pandavas, you know, having another go at life and seeing, you know, what happens, and also resolving a lot of the issues that they had within the Mahabharata. And finally, you know, my personal favorite is Draupadi has a love story with one of the Pandavas. So that was fun writing.
If given a choice, was it fun for them to, like, you know, the life that they were leading? Because they were somewhere from the beginning. If we are talking about gender equality, if we are talking about patriarchy, we must not forget about the toxic masculinity, right?
That is
somewhere, like, you know, today when it is true that, you know, when we talk about empowerment, right, we are talking about how we are educating ourselves, getting a job, earning money, paying our own bills, and making the choice, right? Do really they have the choice? Like, they have to. Even today, if the guy is not earning enough money, most of the girls also be like, "Arey yaar, I mean, why should I get married if the guy is not earning more than me?" Do you think that the conversation now from just women empowerment also needs to go towards, if you're talking about gender equality, also needs to go towards breaking the toxic masculinity and the toxicity around it? Like, how do you look at that?
I absolutely think so. I think that patriarchy obviously has put women in a certain box, but it's also put men in a box of their own as well. You know, as you said, men are expected to be the breadwinner, they're expected to be the warriors and fight wars and all of that stuff. There are ideas of masculinity that are very outdated, you know, and also in terms of how men treat women, you know, that's also linked to masculinity and honor as well, especially in our, you know, in our society in the subcontinent. So there's a lot of hurdles even for men, and men who don't fit within that mold are ostracized and punished by society. The Mr. Skuru is a kind of attempt to know or understand where men stand in that equation, as well as redefine what the heroes of the Mahabharata. So, you know, the Pandavas are looked at as epitomes of masculinity, you know, they are the godheads, right? The heroes and the godheads. And in the Mahabharata, they're referred to as bulls amongst men, you know. So there's a lot of that going on. Yudhishthir couldn't say no to the gambling, the game, because of his masculinity. They did all kinds of stuff. I mean, I could go on and on.
Yeah, I don't know how, but
yeah, break that down and see who they are behind all of that and what their choices would be if all that pressure wasn't on.
I was wondering that, you know, when you were writing the story, was it kind of like, what was that mind space like to understand men from a women's perspective? Like,
you know, it's funny because that's always a challenge for a person who's not of the gender that they're writing. So it's kind of, it's hilarious when you read a lot of portrayals of women by male authors, you know, and you have descriptions of women that women would never give to themselves, you know, like she looked in the mirror and she thought, oh, my breasts are looking great today. Do you know what I mean? Like, that's not something that a woman would ever do, looking in the mirror, you know. So there are these hurdles because you're unable to put yourself in the mind space of someone whose experience is so different to yours. And that was a challenge, definitely, I think, for me. I approached it very much with the point of view that men and women, yes, there are gender and expectation differences, but at the end of the day, their reactions and their emotions are human. I'm inspired by the men and the women, definitely, in my life. I don't talk too much about the men around me, you know, that my personal life, I don't really discuss as much. But my brother, I can. He's definitely an inspiration for me. My father as well. Although I can't say that I base any characters on any one man in my life. I don't do that. Actually, a lot of the emotions in the men, right? And this was a problem in Mahabharata. Men couldn't really express their emotions as well, right? So it's difficult to write a male character who is held back by the inability to share his emotions, you know? So you have to kind of go into the feminine aspect of yourself to access those emotions, you know? So I think that a lot of that came from the women in my life as well.
I'm sure, because you are right to an extent. I mean, even in our daily life, we know, right? That, you know, if a guy is like very emotionally expressive, then they kind of get criticized. Like, I mean, the very basic thing of like, if a guy is crying, it's like, ladku ki tarah mat roya kar. And I'm like, dude, jab ek bachcha paida hota hai, to chahe wo ladka ho ya ladki ho, the pehla cheez saans lene ke baad wo yehi karte ki wo rote hai. Tab to aap nahi kehte ki, are pata hai, ladka hua, lekin na ro raha hai ladkiyon ki tarah. Ye to nahi kehte ho.
Yeah, no, there's a lot of barriers that we need to break down as far as the men go.
What are the two very positive change that you have observed from the time you wrote your first book, say, to now, in this whole topic of feminism and gender equality?
I think one of the biggest things that I have noticed changing in the feminist space in India, since I started writing, is the hashtag MeToo movement. That has really sort of changed a lot of industries. Back when I was working in filmmaking, the idea of being sexually harassed was fairly commonplace. And women had to just look out for themselves, you know. I was sexually harassed multiple times, you know. I was stalked, all kinds of stuff happened back in the day, right? And there was nobody you could go to and say, oh, you know, or there was no Twitter where you could go and say, this person did this and that person said that, you know. There was no accountability back in those days. So I think that one of the best things that's happened is that we have put that sort of awareness out there that, you know, if somebody crosses a line, there is something that women can do about it. You know, we've given women a way to stand up for themselves. And I think that's wonderful.
Why did you not kind of, take the name of those people who are, tried to harass you?
Well, Twitter came along much later. So, there's really no point in naming people that aren't well known or don't have, you know, I mean, back then I didn't even keep in touch with anybody, you know, it was so many years ago. So a lot of the time you just kind of avoided those kinds of people. Twitter and the ability for people to have accounts and all of that came a lot later. We're talking back in the day of emails when I was working. There was no Facebook, there was no Instagram, there was no Twitter. I don't know where any of the men who harassed me are, what they're doing, you know, none of these people are celebrities, you know. So, yeah, you move on, you know.
But do you think I'm just trying to get a little more insight off this, that, you know, do you think these days also, like when women are sharing their stories, especially like, you know, if they faced any sexual harassment or anything, do you think somewhere it also kind of they fear that, you know, if they disclose their name, you know, they might just be shamed later on. You know, that's why at times they just cannot own their own story.
I think that a lot of women feel that way. I think that it's not as much in especially in urban areas with women who are working in, for example, media, like yourself. The shame factor is not as strong as the financial factor. You know, a lot of the times the men potentially who are harassing you are have some sort of power over your workspace, or you know, can affect your career and all of that stuff. So I think that women often keep quiet because they don't want to compromise their careers, you know, and they don't want to piss people off and then not get the job or get fired or get. So I think there are a lot of women don't come out because of that. I think from my point of view, you know, it just depends from now onwards how seriously we take it going forward. If there are repercussions for men who act out, then the it reduces drastically the amount of sexual harassment that happens in the first place, you know, which it already has done. So then you're talking not so much of the isolated cases in which it does happen. You're talking about an overall shift in thinking, saying, no, yes, before it happens, I'm going to stop. So this is a good prevention as opposed to a cure.